gentlemen.
Moonlighter has sweet pixel art and animation.
You have my curiosity.
But also addictive cave diving and shopkeeping.
Now you have my attention.
Now you want to make sure you're not missing anything important. Here's some tips I wish I knew when I started playing the game. Let's start with some basics. If you die, you only keep what's on you and the top row of your inventory. Everything else gets deleted. While exploring, you get a good amount of time to look around, but if you stay too long, this green giant monster spawns and dogs you until you leave or die. It one-hits items, chests, and your hero, so it's best to avoid this thing. Oh, and sometimes you aren't locked in a room. Check the doors if things get dicey, as you can sometimes run away if you need to. Another survival tip is that weapons can attack through objects if they have the range, and your attacks can collect items for you as well. This makes the spear and big sword really useful behind cover. Keep in mind that the bow and arrow can only shoot through objects if you charge your shot though. Sometimes you might enter a room and see these sparkles emanating from the darkness. Try falling and see what's down there. There are a few secrets you may find. If you notice a solitary chest, it will take any item you put inside and teleport it back home. Items sent home like this or by the cursed items will always land in the topmost treasure you have back at base. Another secret room may have this pillar thing. Interact with it to summon a wave of monsters. Beat that wave and be rewarded with a chest. You can keep summoning more waves after each win to upgrade your chest to the max rarity and reward, and this max chest gives you some pretty rare accessories. Okay, when you're ready to start selling, keep these tips in mind. Keep an eye out for these little bubbles that appear over shoppers' heads. If you're observant, you might notice a thief enter before they even try to steal from you. Don't forget that you can sell items from behind or in front of the cash register, so keep a watchful eye and be ready to pounce. These arrows indicate the item's popularity. Selling too much of an item will lower its popularity and force you to reduce your price. High popularity will allow you to charge a little more than normal. Wealthy people are always willing to buy an item at a little higher price than normal as well. This means you can change the price of something a rich person is interested in by following them around. Make sure to use this tab on the right that has some really useful information about previous prices that you've tried. To figure out the right price for a new item, I would sell one at a time and adjust the price as I go. This may feel slow, but it helps you nail down a price and also gives you room to find the highest price people are willing to pay. Customers with a sword and a helmet bubble are heroes, and they'll only buy potions or equipment like weapons or armor, and note that you can't sell amulets. You can also determine prices by looking at Le Retailer's shop. He's always jacking the price up 4.5 times, so you can technically check his price and divide that by 4.5 like a math whiz. Or you can also use other tools like the merchant mirror or sale box. The mirror tends to give you a third of the price for an item, so multiply that by 3 to get a good estimate. The sale box has some more nuance, so if you're really interested in using it, I encourage you to check some research online. But to be clear, I didn't even do any of this min-maxing, and I murdered this game, so don't worry if it seems like too much for you. Remember how if you're quick enough you can change the price of a rich person's sale? Well, if you notice a customer give a reaction showing the item price was too low, you can actually pick it up before they even take it off the shelf, canceling the sale. Sure, this will upset them a little, but it gives you a chance to place the item again and augment the price. Also, if you see a customer happy with the price and you have more in your inventory, you can drop all the extra supplies in that stack before they pick it up and they will happily buy it all. Finally, when you get these showcases, thieves can't steal from them, and they also make the item inside more popular, allowing you to sell it for a higher price, but only wealthy customers visit them. Okay, time to upgrade your gear. The forge craft several weapon types if you have the required materials and money. Don't forget to wishlist the gear you want so that those items will show up with a star, reminding you to save instead of sell them. The witch is useful as well, since she sells all sorts of potions, but it's a bit pricey. Instead, I focused on her enchantments, which require money and these crystals. The enchantments will grant some special effect to your weapon, like a chance to stun or to apply poison, fire, or electricity to your attacks. Lastly, I definitely found the bow and arrow to be critical in my run. I'd often change up my primary weapon, but without a solid ranged weapon like a bow, spear, or big sword, the dungeons can be really tough. When deciding on shop upgrades, I recommend getting anything which increases money flow. I always upgraded my register first, since it grants you a percentage tip automatically added to your sales, and when I hired the hawker, I always focused on packing my shop with decorations that further increased tips, customer speed, and max number of patrons allowed in the shop. Upgrading your chest will only increase the capacity of your main chest, the one next to your bed. I avoided getting the sale box until later on. I only found it useful when I was swimming in items that sell for such a low price, since customers visit the sale box at least once, allowing you to move products fast. Just outside your shop is a fenced area which houses the familiars you find in the dungeon. They start off as eggs and need some time to hatch, but be sure to start using these as soon as they become available, since they grant some amazing benefits. I'll link some details about familiars in my description below, but I wanted to highlight my favorite, the Mimic. It tries to collect items dropped after combat, and you can even interact with it to manually unload all the stuff you're carrying. Also, remember those curses I was talking about before? The Mimic ignores all of them, meaning you can just drop off and go. And that's not all. If you die, the Mimic still retains everything it was carrying, even if you lost most of the stuff you had. So it's best to keep as many items on it rather than you, especially before a boss battle. Finally, once you beat the game, you get a chance to start a new Game Plus mode. This needs you to select a completed game file and will transfer your character, but only the potions and equipment he had equipped at the time. All other money, gear, items, and upgrades will be gone. Everything from enemies to prices are all buffed, meaning you'll need to go through all the upgrading and selling you did in your previous run. Be sure to check out the new items at the Forge. There's new weapons you can craft, and the Witch even offers a new way to enchant your gear. Drop additional tips or corrections in the comments, and consider subscribing to help out my growing channel.